This may be the most controversial book about nutrition to appear in the last decade. Yet it's not a diet book. It doesn't give irresponsible advice. It doesn't ask you to sacrifice your long-term health so you can drop a few pounds. To the contrary, its whole focus is on improving long-term health. What's more, it's written by someone who actually had a career in nutrition science. Yet T. Colin Campbell's book, The China Study, might fairly be called radical, especially in a cultural sense. It was not enough for Campbell to just say the healthiest foods are whole plant foods. He went much further than that. He said animal-sourced foods are big culprits in causing chronic disease. Unlike what you'll see in the writings of other nutrition professionals, he does not make a virtue of moderation. For Campbell, there is no middle ground. Whole plant foods are where you'll find proper nutrition, period. I can understand why that message would be hard to swallow for a lot of people. He's asking a lot of us. That's beside the point, however. What interests me is whether or not he is right. Being radical does not make you wrong. Having researched these issues, I've concluded that his views are basically correct. Now, I'm sure it's no surprise to you at this point that I'd say that. So rather than offering a T. Colin Campbell puff piece in this section, I'll engage his critics and take their charges seriously. Campbell has really put himself out there with an uncompromising and unusual opinion, so if he's wrong, his critics should have no problem exposing his mistakes. Search the China Study and you'll see his critics are many. They appear soon after the usual sites you might expect for a prominent book. A wiki page, the author's page, some shopping options. Then look down a bit to the last three here if you can make them out. The link third from the bottom, called The China Study Factor Fallacy, is a critique created by Denise Minger. The title doesn't make any sense, but I won't digress. I wasn't all that interested in her take on this book, and I originally did not plan on including her in these videos. Her posts about the China Study are pretty long, and she is mostly just disputing the ways numbers were crunched. I don't have the expertise nor the interest to properly fact-check her analysis of it. What pushed me to include her was that last search result you see on this slide. Science-Based Medicine is a very useful and interesting site for anyone concerned about health matters, and its most famous blogger, Stephen Novella, is someone I admire a lot. So you will understand my disappointment at this headline. That Science-Based Medicine would be one of the sites bashing this book really disappoints me. I want them to be better than this. I'll show you what I mean. The author of their article, Dr. Harriet Hall, says a new analysis of the China Study does not support Campbell's vegetarian ideology. This has the ring of a news bulletin, as if the proper authorities have finally weighed in. That's not the case. This is about Denise Minger's blog. This raises some questions for me. A new analysis? Is it better than the original analysis? How has Harriet Hall determined that? Bear in mind, this new analysis was not published in a peer-reviewed journal. It was just a blog posting on a raw foodist's personal site. Does Dr. Hall regularly read the raw food blogs? Is there a reason she is so confident in Minger's competence to analyze the copious data from the China Study? Is she sure Ms. Minger can produce a plausible, fair, and responsible interpretation of it? Getting into the content, she faults Campbell for failing to tell us that in his data, wheat is strongly correlated with heart disease, but animal food is not. This is what Minger says, and apparently she is in full agreement with her. Why is she so quick to accept this assertion? I wonder what special skeptical tools she is using to assess all this. After all, the nutrition transition is an important topic in public health these days, and China is one of the countries experiencing it the most. Their diets are changing fast, as are their rates of obesity and diet-related disease. Is it their increased fruit consumption that is causing their problems? Can grains be blamed even though they are being consumed less by all income groups in recent years? The trend in China is away from wheat consumption and toward greater meat consumption. These trends are associated with increasing disease. What could Minger have said to make Dr. Hall ignore these basic facts? Other studies showing similar conclusions about food and cancer to Campbell's were published before his. Is she similarly suspicious of those? If someone looks at the China Study with some skepticism, I can understand that. After all, most published research findings are suspect, as I'll discuss in my Waking to Realities section. However, one's degree of skepticism should be proportional to the claims being made and who is making the claims. The China Study should not stand out as such a lightning rod from this perspective. There's plenty of evidence to support his ideas beyond his own research. You can take or leave his conclusions, but let's first put the China study in context. What have other researchers had to say about diet and health in recent years? Here is a major recent study of a large cohort in China that compared the effect on mortality rates of vegetable-rich, fruit-rich, and meat-rich diets. The conclusion states, in general, a fruit-rich diet was related to lower mortality, whereas a meat-rich diet appeared to increase the probability of death. Here, a population-based study of Chinese women found a link between animal proteins and saturated fats with breast cancer. Here is a study that showed major health advantages for Chinese vegetarians, including lower body mass index and lower blood pressure, and better cholesterol numbers. These advantages were bigger the longer someone was vegetarian. The World Cancer Research Fund and the American Institute for Cancer Research examined the effects of various dietary factors on specific cancers. They created a very clear chart to represent their assessments. You should have a look at it. If you do, Campbell's ideas don't seem so radical. The funny thing about the uproar over his book is that when a committed meat eater hears a result he or she does not like from a modern professional work like the China study, you can be sure they will protest that correlation does not equal causation. Yet if Denise Minger says wheat causes heart disease, or Lauren Cordain says that populations 100,000 years ago were free of chronic disease, they just accept it without question. Whole wheat is associated with lower rates of cancer. It is also associated with lower rates of heart disease. Why deny this? And how are you going to do a population-based study on people who died tens of thousands of years before civilization? Some people have breathtaking double standards. I'd like to point out that on the topic of carbs, Campbell seems rather mainstream. Like virtually all health professionals, Campbell is not a promoter of refined carbohydrates. Harriet Hall calls herself the Skeptoc, and she has been active in the skeptical community. Unfortunately, just calling yourself a skeptic is not enough to make you one. Skeptics know they have their own biases, and they know they have to at least try to account for them. Dr. Hall had already made her biases concerning nutrition clear. She had quite a skeptical take on the diet former President Bill Clinton adopted to achieve his dramatic weight loss. She dismissed the work of the three doctors who informed his change in lifestyle. In reference to Colin Campbell, she dismisses his amazing assertion that over a period of years, some provinces in China did not report a single heart attack in anyone under 64, even though their populations were in the tens of thousands. That doesn't tell us anything, she says. Thanks for the serious analysis, Doc. She considers the connection between saturated fat and heart disease to be debunked by Gary Taubes. Taubes used lots of references, she says, so I guess in her mind that means he's right. You can find a far more informed and skeptical take on Gary Taubes than hers if you visit the website of the excellent low-carb blogger CarbSane. You can see she has kept herself busy trying to fact-check Gary Taubes and his book Good Calories, Bad Calories. This blog recently debunked Taubes' core beliefs. Dr. Hall should check it out. This thorough critique of Taubes by an obesity specialist should be on her reading list as well. Why assume the science writer Taubes understands obesity better than a top obesity researcher, doctor? Because you want to believe him? Because he used a lot of footnotes? Amazingly, she even references the International Network of Cholesterol Skeptics in her critique. Her language reveals that she, like Uffe Ravenscoff, may have hedonic barriers that prevent her from taking a clear-eyed look at nutrition. She assumes Clinton's diet was a difficult lifestyle adjustment. Has she tried it? Did she skeptically research this? She also thinks one must renounce avocados to meet the recommendations of these doctors for some reason. I'll get to that in a moment, but notice, she indulges in some snarkiness with a rather personal parting shot at Bill Clinton at the end. The Skeptoc is apparently not above pandering with this cheap non sequitur. Where does she get this idea that Bill Clinton can never again taste an avocado? There is nothing about avocados in Dean Ornish's book about reversing heart disease, and he is one of the doctors she takes to task. If he changed his mind when he wrote The Spectrum in 2007, he has a funny way of showing it. Maybe his multiple tips for eating avocados are only there to tempt and torment heart disease patients. Another doctor she turns her skepticism toward is Caldwell Esselstyn, who only restricts avocados for cardiac patients with elevated lipid scores. Dr. Campbell himself is practically an avocado pusher, telling you to eat all you want. Dr. Hall should at a minimum offer a retraction of her avocado-based fib. Dr. Hall has used her critical thinking skills to address fears over vaccines and autism. In doing so, she's a defender of good science. The National Academy of Sciences would agree with her. Their expert food and nutrition board might wonder, however, why she trusts Gary Taubes and the International Network of Cholesterol Skeptics so much more than them. I hope Dr. Hall takes a look around the internet and asks herself if the Skeptoc should be endorsing fringe movements so uncritically. Having vented about science-based medicine, in part two, I'll turn to Denise Menger.